What else?
Sir, I sent a pic, the 30th one of the previous chapter.
30th 30.
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay, so here is another question. Parallel beam of light of wavelength 100 nanometer. Who all have joined now other than Ramcharan, Kondanya and Amog? Anybody else joined in?
No, sir.
So parallel beam of light of, see, today I guess many are not coming since tomorrow is your physics exam in school. So we'll focus on problem solving only. I'll not be taking up new concepts today. So we'll just take up the questions and see how we can, you know, analyze those. Okay. Not only from these chapters, we'll be taking other chapters also if time permits. So a parallel beam of light of wavelength 100 nanometer passes through a sample of atomic hydrogen in the ground state. Fine. Now assume that when a photon supplies some of its energy to a hydrogen atom, so this is a photon of wavelength this much. So energy of this photon is hc by lambda. Okay. So part of this energy is utilized by the hydrogen atom to excite itself. And rest of the energy is another photon, okay, moving in the same direction as the incident photon. So you can imagine a scenario like this, that you have a glass tube. Inside this glass tube, you have atomic hydrogen. Then a parallel beam is coming like this of wavelength 100 nanometer. Okay. Amog, you did this question?
No, sir.
Okay. Neglecting the light emitted by the excited hydrogen atom in the direction of incident beam, what wavelengths may be observed in the transmitted beam? So what it says that when hydrogen atom get excited, from n equal to 1, it could go to n equal to 2, 3, 4, like that. Okay. So when hydrogen atom gets excited, it will get de-excited also. So whatever wavelength gets emitted because of the de-excitation of hydrogen atom, that doesn't come in the direction of parallel beam. So parallel beam direction is this, x-axis. So when hydrogen atom gets de-excited, probably those wavelengths get emitted perpendicular to the direction of the incident ray. Fine. So we need to find what? We need to find what wavelength is observed in the transmitted beam. So this wavelength we need to find. So this is lambda 1, let's say lambda incident. So lambda transmitted is what? Can you tell me how you will analyze this situation before solving? It is given that some part of the energy is used by the hydrogen atom to excite itself and rest of the energy is rejected. So you have to find out wavelengths that are observed in the transmitted beam. Any ideas how will you do this? Okay, see here. First, we will try to find out energy of the photon, which is how much? In terms of electron volt, it will be hc by e lambda. Can you quickly find out how many electron volt the energy of the photon is? This is incident photon.
So 12.42 electron volts.
Sure.
So yeah, I think so.
This will be 6.6 into 3.
Yes.
So it will be 12.4 electron volts, you're saying.
Yeah.
Now, see, this photon excites the hydrogen atom from its ground state, right? At the ground state, the energy is minus 13.6 electron volt. This is n equal to 1. So after excitement, it will go to n equal to 2, which is 3.4 electron volt, or it could go to, you guys remember these values, right?
Yes, sir. Minus 1.9 and 0.8.
Correct. So this is n equal to 4 minus 0.85 electron volt. Now it is given that all the hydrogen atoms were in the ground state. So this gap is what? This gap is 10.2 electron volt. Okay, so out of 12.4 electron volt, it will absorb 10.2 electron volt. So how much will be remaining? 2.2 electron volt. Fine. So when you equate this to the photon of this much energy in terms of electron volts, you'll be getting wavelength of the transmitted beam, because it will absorb 10.2 electron volt out of 12.4 and reject 2.2 electron volt. Are you getting this?
Yes, sir.
So this is one wavelength, and then it could go to n equal to 3 probably. How much is this energy gap from n equal to 1 to n equal to 3?
12.1.
So it will go to n equal to 3 also. So balance of the energy, which is 0.3 electron volt, this will also emit a photon, lambda transmitted 2 wavelength. Now, what is the difference in energy between 1 and 4? How much it is?
12.7.
So it will not be able to go to n equal to 4. Yes or no?
Yes.
What if the n equal to 2 excited electron absorbs further? It can jump up. Are you getting it?
Yes, sir.
Right? But then we are ignoring that scenario because I think in the question also that scenario is not taken up. So we'll assume that everything is happening from ground state onwards. So there will be two wavelengths that will be getting transmitted. Is this thing clear?
Yes.
Now B part is a radiation detector is placed near to the gas to detect the radiation coming perpendicular to the incident beam. We need to find out the wavelength of radiation that may be detected by the detector. I think Naman joined from YouTube. Naman, if you have any doubts, please WhatsApp me with the pic of your doubt. I can take it up here itself. Huh. So now there's a detector which detects the radiation coming perpendicular direction. So beam will go along x-axis. Perpendicular to beam, the photons will come from where? Which photons will come perpendicular to beam? These electrons which are excited when they get de-excited. You're getting it? These will emit photons. These photons will come out perpendicular direction. Getting it? It is written that beam will go parallel and the wavelengths that are emitted because of de-excitation, once it get excited, will be coming perpendicular to the direction of the incident. Fine?
Okay.
So that's it. No other doubts?
No, sir.
Okay. Fine. So let me give you few questions. So initially we'll take up questions from HC Verma, then I'll open up past year photoelectric effect we haven't done yet, right? For Kormangla we haven't done, at least.
Yes, we haven't done too much.
For Indranagar we did.
Yes, sir.
What other chapter is left other than atoms for Kormangla?
So we haven't done communication systems.
Okay, that's a small thing.
Yeah, so other than that.
Other than that, we have done.
Yeah, magnetism and matter also.
Oh, okay, that also.
Yeah, yes.
So we haven't done magnetism and matter.
See, magnetism and matter, I have taken a class already. Fine.
Yes.
So that was also online only. So exactly the way I take the class. So if it is possible, we can focus our class timings on problem solving and you can watch that.
Okay.
Anyways, like, it's totally up to you. We can discuss that later on also. Tell me that. Fine. So let us do this particular thing. Which particular question you guys are in? 23rd, you said, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. We'll be taking up. Try to do 28th. Meanwhile, I'll get a book on past year JEE questions.
Sir, we haven't done semiconductors also.
Okay, but we have revised so many class 11 chapters, so I guess that's how you guys are ahead. I was wondering how many chapters.
Yes, sir.
Should I do it?
Just be 270.
Others? See, this question doesn't require any calculation as such. Okay, so I guess some of you are doing a lot of calculations. But that's a natural tendency, you know. But then at times you have to look at the question very carefully. Here, you see that, you know, sample gives 5 into 10 to the power 9 gamma rays per second initially, and it drops to 2.5 into 10 to the power 9 per second finally. So there is a drop of half in terms of activity. Now, this is the activity of iron or activity of cobalt? Tell me.
Activity of cobalt.
Who emits gamma? Who is emitting gamma?
Fe.
So this is the activity of Fe, right?
Yeah.
But then the half-life of gamma radiation is extremely small, as if it is negligible, right? So immediately when Fe gets formed, it goes to ground state by emitting gamma radiation. Okay, so the activity of the iron, okay, is proportional to how many excited iron nucleus get formed. Yes or no? See, cobalt will give you iron in its excited state. Then excited state of iron get converted into the ground state of iron by emitting gamma. So this gamma radiation number is proportional to how many excited iron nucleuses are there. Fine. And the number of excited iron nucleuses that are getting formed is equal to number of cobalt nucleuses that are decreasing.
Yes. Yeah.
Right. So rate of formation of iron is equal to rate of decay of cobalt.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
And rate of decay of cobalt is proportional to number of cobalt. So it is exactly half life. From 5, it goes to 2.5. Are you getting what I'm trying to say here?
Yes, sir.
See, the number of iron excited state getting formed per second is equal to number of cobalt that are getting decayed per second. And number of cobalt decayed per second is proportional to number of cobalt. And number of decay per second, they are given. So you can understand it takes only half life.